Hi, I'm back with part two of looking at 1 Corinthians verses 18 right through to 31. Now, I'll backtrack a little bit, but brothers, think of what, this is verse 26, brothers, think of what you were when you were caught. So think of where you were. Think of the time that you decided to believe. Think of the time of where you were at the time. Think of what happened to you, and think about where were you when you decided to give your life to Jesus Christ. That's an interesting one. But think about it, because it says here, brothers, think of what you were when you were caught. Not many of you were wise, but human standards, not many were influential, and not many of you were noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. And God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. So you can be that strong in God, God may shame. God will choose the weak things. God will choose weak people. And God will choose the weak things of the world to shame the strong, to remind the world that it is God's world, and it's the word of God, and through the blood of Jesus Christ, God's word stands. So at the end of the day, when you look at this, God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God shows mercy and grace. And through mercy, God will show these strong things. And when you look at God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. And this is where he's saying in 1 Corinthians 19, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, for the intelligence and the intelligence I will frustrate. Well, obviously, wise, being so wise, you can be so strong. And having wisdom could mean that you are strong and you are wise, and your intelligence can mean that you are strong. But there is a difference when you look at this. You can have wisdom and you can be intelligent, but you can also humble yourself to God, and you also can water that down. But from a worldly sense, people can be very, very, very strong and have a lot of wisdom. But this is where it's saying in 1 Corinthians 18, for the message of the cross is a foolishness to those who are perishing. So if you haven't given your life to Jesus Christ, and you wonder why that you keep hitting a brick wall, and you keep having these frustrations after frustrations, is because if you listen to what God's word's saying, for the message of the cross is foolishness. So if you're listening to this tonight, or wherever you are, and you're going, well, for the message of the cross is foolishness, for those who are perishing, but to of us who are being saved, it is the power of God, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and the intelligence of the intelligent, and I will frustrate. So if you are so frustrated and you've never given your life to God, if you suddenly say, well, I want Jesus Christ in my life, and you are one of those people that are saying that are being saved, and you want to be saved tonight, suddenly you can have these burdens lift off you, you can feel less frustrated, you can feel less to the point that you need to have these things of the world. And you will not see the word of God or see what Jesus says in a foolish way again, because you know the truth and you know what Jesus Christ says. And you believe. See, to believe, you've got to have faith to start with. If you have faith, you have faith in a person and you believe what that person's saying, well, then that's faith, because you're stepping out to listen to that person. You're having faith that, okay, I'll listen to this person. And then if you believe what this person's saying, and if that's a message from God, and that's through a man, that God is speaking through a man, and you can hear God's word, and you can hear what God's saying to you, well, then obviously you will give your life to Jesus Christ. You will step out in faith and say, Lord, here I am. I want to give my life to Jesus. See, so if we go back, but God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise, and God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. That's verse 27. He chose the lowly things of the world and despised things and the things that are not to nullify things that are. So it's something that you look at. He chose the lowly things of this world. Of this world, and he despises the things and the things that are not. And the reason he does this is to nullify, to verify the things that are not there, the things that should be there or are not there, so that no one may boast before him. See, you can't boast. You do things from the heart and you do things from loving. So if you want to go out and testify and witness to other people, it's no difference. It's like if you're going to go and sell a motor car, and it could be a Ford Falcon, if you've got to sell that item and you need to sell that car to allow you to live for the next fortnight, well, you'd have to go out and do your research, and you would have to go out and find out what it's about. And it's not about, as it's saying in verse 29, 1 Corinthians 29, so that no one may boast before him. No one may boast before Jesus Christ, well, I've done this God, and I've done this God, and I've done this God. Well, at the end of the day, I'll tell you something now. We may, as humans, testify, talk about our experiences, and we must remember. The thing here is, in 1 Corinthians 29, that no one may boast before him. No one may boast before God. And that's meaning when you're in prayer, you're boasting to God. You're saying, well, I've helped this old lady, I've done this, God, I've done this, and I've done that. And God, I want you to do this for me, and this for me, and this for me. No. God doesn't ask us to come in prayer to boast to him. God asks us to come in prayer to ask God what God can do for you and what God can do for other people. God already knows your heart. God already knows what you're about. And God loves you, and he already knows who you are. So why do we need to come in prayer and say, well, this is our shopping list. This is our shopping list. It's got everything on there that I want. I want a car, I want a house, I want a wife, I want kids, I want all these things. And God, if you don't give them to me, this is what I'm going to go and do. It's a choice. It's a personal choice. You make a choice to either believe in God, or you make a choice not to believe in God. So it's a choice. But when we do give our lives to Jesus Christ, and we have Jesus Christ in our life, it's a matter of going boasting to God. And the thing is that we need to somewhat verify and somewhat have that transition period to say, well, the difference is, if you're testifying to another Christian or another person saying, well, I do go out and help people, I serve people, that's a testimony in itself to encourage. So there's a difference in talking about your testimony and encouraging other people, and there is a difference in what you'd call boasting. So I think that could be an interesting one to look up the dictionary, what boasting is, and the difference is what instructions are, and going out this basically psychologically or psychology is explaining, well, I had a good day today, I helped this lady, and then I went to the beach, and as I came from the beach, this man dropped his camera and I picked it up for him. That's not boasting. What boasting is saying, well, I helped this old lady, and when I helped this old lady, she gave me $10, and I'm so good, and I'm so great. That's boasting. It's putting yourself above God, and it's putting yourself on a pedestal above God. And God says in 1 Corinthians verse 29, so no one may boast before him. So you don't boast to God, and certainly you do not put yourself on a pedestal above God. So that, in verse 29, 1 Corinthians, so that no one may boast before him, so it is, this is verse 30, so that it is to because of him that you are in Christ Jesus. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for a wisdom from God, and that is our righteousness and holiness and redemption. Therefore, as is written, let him boast in the Lord. See, boast in the Lord. Boast in what God is doing. Boast in the things of the Lord. You know, that you can boast to the point of saying, well, you know, isn't God great? The grace of God, God's moving through this land, God's doing this, and the Lord's doing this, and the Lord's doing that, and the Lord's blessed me this week because I'm able to pay my bills. That's boasting in the Lord. That's uplifting the Lord. That's giving the Lord the gratification, and giving the God the victory, giving God the glory. And the glory through the blood of Jesus Christ, it's giving God the victory and putting him up on a pedestal and putting you below him. And this is where it's very important to do that. I'll go on to sermon 3 just in a minute.